Good evening, all. We'll start, as usual, first with the prayers to reflect on how to renew our own selfless wish of bodhicitta in listening and reflecting on these teachings, as well as understanding the meanings of these texts and employing them in our acts and doing things in life that are hopefully guided by a motivation that is benevolent and useful for all. So we call upon the enlightened ones to bear witness to renew and taking these, renewing these vows. O fully enlightened, blessed ones, Buddhas dwelling in the ten directions, Bodhisattvas and great Bodhisattvas abiding in the ten stages, great Vajrayana Gurus, please pay attention to me. Until gaining Buddhahood, go for refuge in Buddhas, also Dharma and Sangha, Bodhisattvas assembly, of a body, also wealth, virtues, merits of these three times, with any attachment for the sake of all beings, as also gathers, paths, give rise to bodhicitta, learn bodhisattvas' precepts and train the stages in the court. For the sake of all beings, I embrace bodhicitta and also learn to live by the precept stages in the court. O fully enlightened, blessed ones, Buddhas dwelling in the ten directions, Bodhisattvas and great Bodhisattvas abiding in the ten stages, and great Vajrayana Gurus, please pay attention to me. Until gaining Buddhahood, go for refuge in Buddhas, also Dharma, Sangha, Bodhisattva assembly, offer body, also wealth, virtues, merits of three times, without any attainment, sake of all beings, as also gathered paths, give rise to bodhicitta, learn bodhisattva's precepts, and train stages in accord. For the sake of all beings, I embrace in bodhicitta, also learn to live by the precept stages in accord. O fully enlightened blessed ones, Buddhas dwelling in the ten directions, Bodhisattvas and great Bodhisattvas abide in the ten stages of great Vajrayana Gurus, please pay attention to me. Until gaining Buddhahood, go for refuge in Buddha, also Dharma, Sangha, Bodhisattva assembly. Of a body, also wealth, virtues, merits for three times, without any attachment, for the sake of all beings. As also gathers paths, give rise to bodhicitta, learn bodhisattva's precepts, train stages in accord. For the sake of all beings, I embrace bodhicitta, also learn to live by the precept stages in accord. Now I have reaped life's good fruit, for I have good human life, born in the race of the Buddhas, become indeed Buddha's child. I, from now on, at all costs, whole legacy of this race, this faultless mendicant's race, will never be polluted. In the front of guardian refuges, today I and all beings as my guests, till they attain Sugata stages, may the gods and demigods rejoice. May the excellent bodhicitta take birth, yet not done so. Where it has been born, may it increase freely without degeneration. May I never part bodhicitta, engage in bodhisattva conduct. Being guided bodhicitta's way, may I renounce all evil deeds. In the heart of bodhisattva's mind, intend to help well-for being. Whatever are the wishes of the Lord, may all sentient beings attend them. May all beings possess happiness. May they deserve all three laurels. Bodhisattvas abide in the stages, fulfill all prayers and their wishes. May they strive in all parameters and never forget bodhicitta. May all obstructions and misdeeds become complete in its purity. So we're looking at the eighth chapter, which deals with the dhyana paramita. Dhyana is the meditation. The highest meditation is to develop mindfulness to guard this selflessness, the bodhicitta. And we've gone through the quite good part of this chapter, where Shantideva argued the importance of solitude and freedom from all obstacles, activities, desire, and distractions. So one need to resort to a quiet, peaceful sanctuary where one can then be free from all demands, responsibilities, distraction, indulgence, then can really put your mind to it Because other, even though we like the idea of altruism, but to realize and in your deep meditation, moving experiences, you have to find space, time, and most importantly, the commitment to do that. So therefore, this chapter argues the importance of those. And then now we come to the main meditation. The main meditation is meditation on exchanging the role of self versus other, because when one is thinking full of oneself, one cannot be altruistic. And so to unseat the selfishness, one has to think of selflessness. And selflessness means one has to think of the well-being of others, if not first, at least equally as important that of ours. So training putting oneself in others' shoes and try to feel their happiness and causes how we can best assist, but never harm. And therefore try to feel like the mother who feels child's well-being more important than hers. Or anyone for that matter. Someone really loves somebody, they usually do so willingly at their own inconvenience, but willing to do for the sake of others with great pleasure. So only when someone really loves the person, then they're able to put that, and then they find their stamina, pleasure, and dedication to put themselves to benefit others, make them more happy than doing anything for themselves. So there are such, we see those examples every now and then, but consistently being able to stay in that state of mind, one needs to cultivate meditation. So here we are going through the arguments about the importance of cherishing the well-being of others, and maybe even take the role of, take ourselves their position, take their sufferings on us, and give our happiness to the others. So we have read as far as verse number 102. So now, if there are any arguments from others, such as there were other schools during Shantideva's time in 8th century India, who sometimes argue that is, that's really ideal of helping others and thinking of others, but actually it doesn't work, so to speak. So people have argued that. So here, verse number 113 goes to refute such arguments if they exist in our mind. For instance, it says, thus the suffering of everyone should be dispelled, because suffering of everyone is suffering. Nobody wants suffering. It doesn't matter who's suffering if we can dispel. And here there is no debate, meaning there shouldn't be any argument. If it is anybody suffering, one who thinks of everybody's well-being, we should all dispel those sufferings. To free myself from pain means freeing all. Contrary-wise, I suffer with the pain of beings. So meaning, if one is able to free the sufferings of others, you know, then one is also being freed from sufferings. If one's other people's sufferings are not removed, our own sufferings removed, we feel maybe not comfortable. We feel guilty. We don't feel good of us being able to reach the other shore while leaving everybody drowned in the water, for instance. So therefore, it is very clear that it would not suit our own morale to feel good us having reached the top and while everybody's falling down. And so that's why it is quite arguable from our own side that nobody wishes to see others suffering, and while oneself is free of that. if we see somebody suffering, even though we reach other shore, we suffer as much on top of that guilt. So therefore, one needs to see the demerit of selfishness in this way and see the how much effort can be best invested in removing others' suffering as of ours. One should divest our energy in removing our own suffering if many people's sufferings are ignored. So that's usually the selfish people do that, and then they suffer the consequences even more unimaginably later. So hence that point is very clearly argued in that that, and quite a few of the following verses all the way till verse number 6, 106 are all on that point. The sorrow felt in pity aggravates, because if you feel the sorrows of others, it actually aggravates our own self. You know, so there's no delight in witnessing anybody's sorrow being not removed. You say, pain already felt, so why engender it? The people of other schools in the Charvakas, and they argued, saying that if somebody's suffering is already there, and if we feel their suffering, it only aggravates ours and doesn't remove theirs. So what's the point of you so talking about developing this empathic distress? So you haven't removed their sufferings. It only aggravates your own sorrow. What we people call it also in everyday life, overwhelms. We get overwhelmed by the sufferings of others instead of being able to remove theirs and ours. We neither can remove ours nor could remove theirs, and it aggravates. That's when we don't have the bodhicitta. The whole difference is that. But can the sting of pity be compared with all the other beings have to suffer? So therefore, here Shantideva argues that it's not comparable to the suffering of all other beings. Even if it seems to aggravate you in your own suffering a little bit, maybe you also think their suffering is not removed. But actually, he says, this is a useful suffering. This is useful suffering. It is conquering selfishness and in the long run. And whereas we usually suffer anyway, even without willing to do any good for others, you know. So we are so used to suffering. So this time we might have some kind of upgraded suffering. Use suffering that actually will test and maybe improve our selflessness. And therefore, it is not, question isn't that temporarily whether we are able to remove their sufferings, whether we don't suffer as a result of that or not. Is that we suffer anyway due to every selfishness. So this time we empathize the sufferings of others out of altruism, and therefore our willingness accommodates others' suffering as if they were ours. Now, that kind of ability to boldly embrace sufferings of others, even though maybe their sufferings aren't removed, but what it does is it actually produces enlightened one in the long run, you know. So, of course, if that's the case, if the Buddha has attained enlightenment, all our suffering has been completely removed, you know. But Buddha may not have completely removed, but his enlightenment has empowered us to talk and think and scheme how we can do this too. And hence, the benefit is very obvious. And if through such a single pain, a multitude of sorrows can be remedied. So that's talking about the effectiveness of us feeling pity of other beings suffering. In the long run, when we are able to show the way to others, then everybody will be able to remove their sufferings, multiple sufferings of every being. Once they all heed to these teachings, they will be able to remove many of their sufferings later on by embracing the sufferings of others, you know. Because if one is trying to alienate one's suffering from that others, then we should by now be totally free of sufferings. But we haven't succeeded any removal of our own suffering in the selfish way of enduring suffering. By this, in this particular suffering we are able to take on, it will empower us later on to remove many multitude of suffering which previously we have no way of removing, because they're all caused by selfishness. If the very cause is uncaused, it would not produce similar results. Hence, we need to foresee that vision, that insight. Such pain as this a living being strives to foster in himself and others. So, even thus, Supuscha Chandra, knowing how the king would cause him harm, did nothing to escape the tribulation that the pains of many should overthrow. So there's a story on this more in detail to discuss. Once upon a time, there was a Buddha named Precious Immaculate Moon King. And when that Buddha's doctrine was nearly elapsed, there was a king named Sridatta who dwelt in a palace, and he was indulging in the palace and caught up in misconception. He exiled the Bodhisattva. He exiled the Bodhisattva, others, to a forest. Then even realizing that his own life was in danger, the great Bodhisattva who was exiled, you know, by the king, yeah? The great Bodhisattva who realized that he was exiled and his own life will be put more in danger. The Bodhisattva was already exiled. And now if he was going to do anything, it's going to endanger his life, yeah? So the great Bodhisattva returned to the king's palace to teach the Dharma. As a result of which hundreds and thousands of million sentient beings were placed in irresistible state, meaning. So he was already punished for what he was doing. And he, instead of going into exile, he came to suffer more whatever king would have put on him. Then the king ordered his executioner to gradually cut off the Bodhisattva's hands and the legs and extract both of his eyes, which eventually killed the Bodhisattva. The Bodhisattva didn't want it to just be satisfied with his exile. You know, he was going to be exiled anyway, so he might as well get a good exile. So he, in the meantime, before they can destroy him, annihilating totally, he came back to the palace and taught the Dharma, you know. So what he's saying is that he didn't mind. He was already going to be exiled anyway, so he might as well have his exile useful while teaching the Dharma, you know. When the Bodhisattva died, from his body, amazing number of auspicious signs were displayed. The king regretted his action. He never knew the Bodhisattva was such an enlightened being, and then supplicated the Bodhisattva. This is taught in a particular sutra, Samadhi Raja Sutra, that a Bodhisattva who is who has realized or conceiving to wishing to do the practice of taking on more suffering when you're going through suffering, instead of trying to reduce one's own suffering, try to make one's suffering useful by taking on more suffering. So that in the meantime, before the suffering totally exterminate him, he's able to do little good that he otherwise wouldn't be able to do if he's complaining, whinging about the small suffering, which most people do. They'll be always whinging about small suffering and make it many times worse and don't get to achieve anything good. But Bodhisattva, even they're suffering, they take on more difficulties in order to accomplish the very act of taking on the sufferings of others, you know, taking on the sufferings of others. So that's the verse number 106. Concludes that bit. And so now, having argued the importance of, that story has exemplified the need to be willing to take on sufferings, one's own suffering is miserable. The sufferings of others makes us useful to forbear for the very paramitas, such as tolerance, such as endurance, joy, and just delightful to remove your own suffering, but not willing to remove other's suffering. It's not a bodhisattva, you know. I done my bit and put the feet up. But being able to take on the sufferings of others on top of one's own suffering will then be very, very useful. So having explained that, now from next three verses, 7, 8, 9, these three verses goes to explain the benefit of meditating on the equality of self and others, yeah? This is talking about the others suffer. So if others, many people, others suffering, then why should I not willing to take on the suffering, share their suffering, since I'm also suffering? My own suffering is useless suffering. And at least taking on the suffering would be good. So this is practice of promoting equality of suffering of others. It's just like, say as an example, maybe you escape the danger and three others are stuck. You know, they can see you're safe, you know. And then maybe they aren't really safe, but you stay behind. You know, just didn't disappear. You just stay behind, giving them. They know that you are still there. You know, so you are cheering them or doing whatever you can. Maybe there isn't a lot that you can totally do, but just the fact that you didn't just think of your own safety gives them moral support, isn't it? Give them feel the very sentiment the person did that, and makes them feel as supported, isn't it? So this is what we're talking about. You know. Bodhisattva needs to put themselves in the place of others, saying they are like me, just they also want happiness and they also don't want suffering. They also want somebody trying to help. They want to see somebody helping or trying to help. If see no one help, they will be really disappointed. Even though he couldn't really help, but to see someone is still trying will also make the three suffer person who's suffering feel morally supported. This is what it's talking about. I'm sure that's very, very, the benefit is pretty, very, very, very obvious. Here, the verse number 107 goes to address that here. It says, those whose minds are practiced in this way, meaning just like the bodhisattva, whose happiness it is to soothe the pain of others. Yeah, if he's got any happiness, it's not for him to celebrate and dance up and down. His happiness is so as to share to others and soothe and reduce the sufferings of others by at all costs. Will venture in the hell of unremitting agony as swans sweep down upon a lotus lake. It's talking about if the mind of the bodhisattva's mental continuum become very familiar with helping others, you know, for them to face other people's suffering is like swimming in style. It's just like swans swimming, you know. It's not like fleeing in disgust or desperation, but being able to be with others' suffering is like the very purpose of the existence is realized. And so it states in one of the sutras says, having compassion, what could become suffering, you know? What is suffering if you have compassion? It's the very thing you can best work with, you know? You know, even your compassion that exists already probably was cultivated through compassion, suffering. So more suffering, more compassion. If less suffering, no compassion. No compassion whatsoever. Hence, for the bodhisattva to mature, he needs the raw material. He needs the sentient beings whose suffering, alleviation of whose suffering, their happiness only useful for. They don't have any personal reason to have happiness for. Full stop. If they have a little upper ground to be of some advantage, it is so that they can pull up those who are in a lower ground. If not, what's the point of being an upper ground? So it's not about, gaining victory for oneself and ignoring the other. Bodhisattva is there to be like a shepherd, like a bodhisattva. Has to make sure all flocks, sentient being like flocks, has to be put in safety, not reaching himself in the home first. So that being the case, its benefit of equality is there is a lot of purposefulness existing. The purpose becomes very useful purpose to be alive, actually. The ocean-like immensity of joy arising when all beings will be freed. Just even the just vision of being able to free others through one's own willingness to be the last one to leave, so to speak. It's the joy, even the joy that comes is not lack of one's suffering. Joy of having a useful suffering that overcomes selfishness. And therefore, one knows that this joy, this selflessness enthusiasm can assist and guide others. Therefore, it's worthy of celebrating. Selfish joy or victory is cause of no joy. It's almost like shame. And hence, Bodhisattva will understand this way. So, will this not be enough, you know? Will this not satisfy the wish for my own freedom? What is that to me? Bodhisattva will keep asking. And he doesn't try to put a ceiling on what he does to remove suffering or get himself happier. He's not trying to put a ceiling or kind of demarcation how much is enough as long as he's comfortable, you know. And he knows that will be not satisfactory. And he is to conquer one's ego and to be of use for the benefit of others. So one's own freedom is a cause of a great disappointment, you know, disappointment. So what would be the benefit of us reaching on the other shore ahead of everybody while everybody is drowning, you know? What use would that mean? It would be completely like a the cause of great shame. And so, whereas a bodhisattva who is actually able to share with the suffering other sentient beings, it's the very bravery. In this society, we'll call bravery, someone who stayed behind and with the others who are in danger and rescue few, or at least he or she stood there with others, would be considered bravery. One who escaped beforehand everybody is maybe a bit lucky, but not so useful later on. So that's why one needs to make a positive comparison. How many times we always think of I first. Here, Bodhisattva is I last, and others first, almost thinking in that attitude. The work of bringing benefit to beings will not then make me proud and self-admiring. The happiness of others is itself my satisfaction. I do not expect another recompense. So Bodhisattva have to remind, because he's meditating. This is his meditation. It's not sitting in a cushion or somewhere quietly meditating, but actually going and getting his hands wet and socks dirtied, so to speak, getting really engaged and all kinds of inconveniences biting his, but being able to make a small difference to other is worthwhile for every suffering of his is a pleasure for him. Bodhisattva don't feel sufferings for themselves. They don't make sufferings by their own mind because there's no selfishness. And so therefore, their happiness to serve others makes the temporal suffering useful sufferings because they are suffering anyway in this corporal body. So because of that, if they can engage in relieving others' suffering, then the existence, the purpose of their existence is very rewarded. So the Bodhisattva therefore look at the upshot of the benefit of sharing and being with those who suffer, rather than who succeed to escape himself out of all danger and leaving everyone behind. So that's the biggest kind of a distinction between what constitutes a bodhisattva. Is a bodhisattva means warrior, enlightened warrior. Is enlightened enough to see this, the demerit of selfishness, and therefore not seek any happiness for the sake of selfishness, due to selfishness, and willing to suffer bravely and like a warrior, willing to suffer if the intent to benefit other is one he can guard most. If intent to guard the well-being of others, those suffering he feels is useful suffering, because that suffering actually makes him to have useful to exist, because that suffering does test his compassion if he has any. If he has shallow compassion, it gets to grow. If he has no compassion, if one has aversion to suffering, then we will flee. Then it shows that we are not bodhisattva. And if we are not fleeing for our own safety, then at least the suffering is useful, because it becomes cause of one's own compassion. One's own compassion makes oneself willing to suffer for higher purposes, and it is this that makes the what you call benefit of meditating on the equality of oneself and others. So, hence, having made that point, now, next 2.5 verses goes to advice to the meditator. Therefore, a meditator should now realize this, and the work of bringing, work of benefit, I think we've done that. Just as I defend myself from all unpleasant happenings, however small, likewise I should act for others' sake, to guard and shield them with compassion. Now the bodhisattva is actually doing the bodhicitta, bodhisattva's act, not just wish, not just prayer, but actually, just as I go and usually do whatever to remove even slightest sort of difficulty, we quickly go and do, you know, we quickly interrupt whatever we're doing, however small we do, I will do just as quickly as if someone else inconvenience, straight away as if occurring to us. You know, somebody is very attentive to your well-being, they do that, isn't it? Quickly, they're straight away on the spot, they quickly put you out of some difficulty because they're so attentive to your well-being. We can call attendant or nurses or carers or people who are loved ones. They are maybe themselves a little bit exposed to some inconvenience, but they're not thinking of that. The power of attentiveness, of selflessness on the other is they don't even feel their own suffering. It's too insignificant to be thinking about that. When their whole heart is to notice and to be there at service, and so they quickly will attentively remove. So likewise, I shall act for others' sake to guard and shield them from the suffering with compassion. So therefore, the fire may fall on our jacket, or the debris may fall on our boots, or whatever, but then at least it doesn't allow the debris to fall on somebody else. This is what we call bravery in society, who have rescued people in tragedy, and lots of them are firefighters and SES volunteer people who do those things. You can see they do this not to show them some bravery or something. They actually want, their intent is to save the person or persons who are likely to face the catastrophe had they not quick thinking, you know, climb through the long ladder, through the back of the house, through this burning house or whatever, you know. So that is because they are able to, so that they can actually defend. Maybe their legs and hands are, maybe parts of the body are fire burned or whatever, but they are able to do that. That kind of activity, guarding and shielding other suffering, is what we should do in everyday life. That's what it really is saying. We should try to do that like a bodhisattva's meditation is not in the cave. In the cave, we are contemplating, we are scheming. We're reading Shantideva and we say, oh yes, Shantideva, we'll do this. But in actually, this is now the engaged bodhisattva's way of life of putting ourselves in other space and then treating them as equal. And however small our suffering we remove, we also do the same for the convenience of other sentient beings. So The argument, of course, arises whether the body is ours. How come we want to do that? That's other people's body. I feel pain on my body, not when other people's body sort of. And then he argues, although the drop of sperm and blood is alien and in itself devoid of entity, because people think that that's other people's body. But sperm and blood is not your body either. Sperm and blood from which your body was made is from mother and father, who's also other people. So if you identify yourself as an entity, biological entity, it was not you, it was theirs. It was theirs, and it just become big theirs, and you think it's yours. Parents always think we are theirs. They never think you are you. They say, my big boy. My big girl. They say that. So, yeah, you know, if you think about what is what, you know, you think it's other, you shouldn't be save others because they are other. You know, why you got to learn to think this sperm of others as yours? According to Buddhist teaching, all the bone and brain and marrows all come from white elements, you know. And the flesh and skin and blood all come the red element, you know. Of course, they too are very interdependent chemically, but we don't have anything that is ours, really. So we have been thinking of the ownership of this that is others, and we now feel completely ours and not it is others. So Shantideva is arguing, yet because of strong habituation, you know, we've got so used to thinking it's me, actually it's others borrowed sort of biology, I recognize and claim it as my I. So why don't you learn to develop such kind of ownership that is also my body, that is also my brother human being, that is also my brother sister sentient being, and so on and so forth, because you're so good at owning what is not you. Why don't you also go and have ownership of others? Because Bodhisattva is about extending your sense of concern, not just with this self, but the others. Why then not identify another's body, calling it my I? Yeah. Why don't you call this my I, and vice versa? Why should it be hard to think of this my body as another's? No. So using the argument that saying, oh, I don't feel pain when he feels pain, I feel hurt when it really hurts my body. But once upon a time, it was not our body. It just, we adopted it. You know, it's like adopting a son, you know. Until you adopt the son, he was not your son, you know. Once we adopt the son, then good things happen to the son, we jump up and down. When difficult thing happens to the son, then we think it happens to us, you know. The question is whether we adopt sentient being. You know, they say in the adopt a road in some places. When you adopt a road, you try to do something. Adopt a tree, you try to adopt a sentient being. adopt a sentient being as yours, as a bodhisattva. Slowly, incrementally, I suppose. Adopt one sentient being at a time, more important than yourself. He is also just as equal as me, wanting happiness, do not want sorrow, just as me. In the meantime, this nearest person is my adopted person's well-being. And so when a bodhisattva try to learn, train in this way, we will naturally develop this ability. That's what he's saying. Why then not identify another's body, calling it my I, and so on and so forth? And if you're able to consider this way, then you will learn to develop the actual meditation. So now comes the meditation of actual exchanging of self and others, because it has now argued that self and others are equal. and we should adopt the well-being of others as much as ours. Therefore, we, if we have a position that is better and others have a position that is a little bit more exposed, we should give a try to see we take our position, their position, and give, we give our position to them. So that's actually what overview of how to meditate on exchanging self with others in this verse. Why then not identify another's body calling it is my I, vice versa? Why should it be hard to think of this body as another's? Because it means we are, due to habituation and lack of habituation, there's only difference in my I and other person's I. But if you're starting to take the role of others, then it shouldn't be too hard, because we have done it before. It's not that we haven't done this before, and we are independently self. We are actually, our body itself is come from somebody else. That is not our body, but we made it as ours. So because we have already done it, it's not that we are asking too much. So therefore, we should learn to extend it further. And so therefore it says, seeing then the faults that comes from cherishing myself. From this, then, the intimidation or little unpreparedness and unwillingness that we face, say, then it will reveal the demerit of selfishness. The oceanic qualities that came from loving others, all the wonderful qualities that others have, from the enlightened ones to others have, they all came from cherishing others. All the sufferings, you know, that we see in life are all came from self-cherishing. So this kind of almost weighing the pros and cons of self-cherishing and cherishing others, one need to therefore drop the disadvantageous selfishness and adopt this selflessness, which is very, very meritorious, very, very productive, very beneficial. I shall lay aside all love for self and gain the habit of adopting others. So now it's talking about making a mind that I must not be swayed by selfishness, because all problems were brought and created by it in the past. And I should instead adopt the selflessness which Buddhas and Bodhisattvas have practiced, all of their qualities, which makes us even to bow down to their replicas today, is not because of the art or because of the metal, because of the size or value, because what they did, that is very tall, that is drop the selfishness and adopt the qualities of selflessness. And so I too shall follow the first step, take the first step to lay aside what is selfishness, you know. What is selfishness? And then slowly learn the habit of thinking of others. So this is exchanging oneself. Selfishness is replaced by selflessness. And negligence of others previously is now not allowed to be forgotten or neglected anymore, but put priority to put it at the forefront of practicing that. So. Yeah.
If one has cast aside oneself, how can one hold on to the view of others?
It casts aside one's selfishness. It's selfishness.
But then, is it not selfish to consider others as others?
Well. Thinking of others for their benefit is not selfish, but thinking of others just by me alone, and I should be the one, if main intention is for the sake of others, then the very minute selfishness that is still undercurrent, it's called why selfishness. It's actually productive selfishness. And often people have argued, and in His Holiness Dalai Lama says, you know, That is at least productive selfishness. That's useful, wise selfishness. We can't not totally deny ego. There is a certain element of ego that we must maintain. Otherwise, we could not have any use to benefit others. If you don't have the drive, if you don't have the enthusiasm, if you don't have some kind of confidence, what we call Buddha nature. It's a Buddha nature isn't something I can do it, I only have it. I will do it, I'm in a better position. That they have it, but they are snowed under problems. So therefore, I will sort of wet my socks and go to help them to assist themselves. So it's not saying that I will be the rescuer and they don't have to do anything, you know. Here the image is there that we will drop selfishness and then adopt the selflessness of others, but it's only giving them us a way so that they too be able to do that, isn't it? So in many ways we can empower others. Like Shakyamuni Buddha's enlightenment empowered us to do that. He's not quite lifting us, you know, like that. And I haven't heard anybody lift it freely like that, you know. Until the nirvana without remainder, they call it. Until you all sentient beings are liberated, the ego cannot be diminished. It should be some aspect of an I. I, the Bodhisattva, I, the child of the Buddhas, must not let this be tarnished, and so on. If you don't have that confidence, you can't help it, you know. It's developing what we call Bodhisattva, courageous one, who if blamed by others, he's not worried about it. You know, even if they cut the hands and the nose and ears one by one, you know, before they succeed to do that, he will rescue a few other people. And so his intention is not that he did it, but someone needs to be rescued. It's the intent of it, I suppose. Outwardly, yeah, it looks like a martyrdom, you know. Oh, he did it type of thing, you know. But that intention mustn't be, clinging mustn't be there in the mind of the Bodhisattva. And that's why the whole emptiness, the ninth chapter is how to relinquish the ego altogether, you know. In this chapter on meditation, you're actually learning to create a mind that actually stay very fixed on doing selfless things. But while you are, you know, even you do really, really good, but in the end you have to have wisdom not to get attached to it as oneself, as the rescuer, you know. So that will be, first we should do a few rescuing, and then we make sure that we are not attached to the rescuer. So, yeah.
What
does it mean when it says,
when we refer to Shakyamuni
Buddha as detached enlightenment? Is that detached enlightenment?
Yeah. Because I've read it says, you who won, detached enlightenment. So unattached enlightenment.
Not attached to the enlightenment.
Yeah, I guess
so. Is that right? Yeah, okay. Emptiness of self, emptiness of phenomena. If you're attached to enlightenment, it is an attachment, yeah? So that's why you have to transcend they call the nirvana of non-abiding. Non-abiding nirvana means you're not attached to nirvana because of its peace, yeah? You're not attached to samsara, yeah? Because of you're not stuck in samsara because of your lack of wisdom. You are not even attached to nirvana because of your wisdom. You are not detached from samsara because of your compassion to those who are stuck in samsara. Yeah. So that's just the overview of the reason to meditate on exchanging self with others, up to verse number 113. Now verse number 114 onwards, it goes to explain, detailed explanation, how to take the sufferings of others. How to meditate, thinking of the reason, first for the meditation, and verse number, these three verses goes to address that. It says, hands and other limbs are thought of as the members of a body. Shall we not consider others likewise limbs and members of a living whole? So he's talking about that the reason why we should think of taking sufferings of others, because you know, when you think about hands and legs, they are other to each other. If your leg is burning in fire or something, you don't say, oh, that's him, that's not me. Your hands will go and do anything, you know? so therefore, why should we reject the, not think of the other being's well-being when we are quite see that the separateness of the hand and leg, you know? And so therefore, the reasoning is that we should definitely think of removing the sufferings of others as it was one's own, you know, one's own. And verse number 114. 15 says, just as in this form, devoid of I, the thought of self arose through long habituation. It's talking about what made us to develop clinging to this body. When we say this body is definitely not I or self. Body, if this is a self, we'll call self. We wouldn't say body. Why it should have the name not self, you know? So the body, the word body itself means it's composites. Composites means it is non-single entity. It is comprised of skin and so on. Like if you look at the table, it is a table. The table is a name, but body of the table is the top and the legs and all the panels and the nuts and bolts. So it's composites. So in each of the composites, there's devoid of table. So it's saying, just as this form, devoid of I, this form of the table, devoid of really I, because every part of the table is a composite, not the table. The thought of self arose through long habituation, but we keep saying the table, the table, the table. Table as a whole thing, look at that. But if you zoom in the table, like a computer, if you zoom on the table, you wouldn't see table. You see, so meditation emptiness is just you have to zoom, you know. But when you just merely put a label, it looks like there is a table as a form that exists independently. We don't realize table itself is a composite of many non-tables and then merely labeled as such. Likewise, we got so used to thinking I to this composite, it's called body, and like the Bodhisattva who meditate on selflessness, for instance, they meditate on just altruism, what their body may be getting cold, but they don't suffer the body. You know, that's like great beings when they pass away. Their body is supposed to be decomposing, but they don't suffer the decomposition. They don't suffer that because they don't see the body as self. And hence, they don't have clinging to the body, suffering and aversion to it and all that. Because of that, they almost like overcome the elemental dissolution. They can actually withhold the elemental disintegration. And hence the post-death meditation is meditator do not see his body as self. He does not mourn or sad or afraid that he is dying, because there is no he. There's just the body that is now slowly unpieced together, you know, slowly unscrewed, basically. Why upon the aggregate of living beings should not the thought of I through habit be imputed? So therefore, now you should use counter-argument. Why shouldn't think of other people's body as mine? And actually we do. When we develop a love or attachment, ownership of somebody, like mother who feels the child or son or who feels the sister or whatever, whenever you really think of somebody, when it's your child suffering, you quickly leap out of your bed. When somebody is suffering, we haven't quite adopted them as mine. So, oh, no, it's other guy's child, you see? Some Buddha wouldn't do it. Any child will do it, you know, because they have trained like this maybe. But most people would, whoever they have adopted, or for that matter, it doesn't have to be people. It could be possessions, you know. Oh, bang! Straight away thinking, it's my whatever. Then realize it's not mine. That's okay. It's not my car or not my bike. But if it's our bike, it's almost like it looks like, oh, leg was broken. So that shows that when we develop attachment and ownership of it, we can look after their well-being. People do also spend hours just polishing their old car, whatever. Do all sorts of things to make them shine or look good or for a show or whatever because of that habituation, because of the sense of ownership. And why can't we too, it's saying, Shantideva, develop an ability to feel the other person's body is also ours, and hence not ignore them as some other body. Thus, when I work for others' sake, no reason can there be for boasting or amazement. Meaning, so if you really are doing the practice of exchanging self with others, whenever we do something, we shouldn't think it is anything surprising, anything miraculous, or anything unselfish. For it is just as when I feed myself, I don't expect to be rewarded. So we feed every day and we don't say, I help him today. We don't say, I help him today. But actually, you've been feeding this body that is not you. So when you feed somebody, why you should show some kind of say, oh, I fed you all these years and this is what you do to me. So a lot of parental problems that comes from this, that they're thinking, they're feeding or clothing or somebody, and they want some, they think they're feeding somebody else. They don't think they are feeding themselves. But once we do, it's a pleasure, you know, when we do give to somebody, when we have adopted to as our own well-being, we'd rather have the mother eat and the sister have an uncle or your mother or sister or friend have the better seat than yourself. It's more of pleasure that at least your ailing grandmother find a seat and you can stand on the corner, isn't it? When we have that willingness. So that shows that we're quite capable of caught enduring the hardships while enjoying, rejoicing that our grandmother or someone has actually the seed. And then actually a case like that too. So you can see it's immense. That what Shantideva is saying is exchanging self with others is a mental training. We got so habituated thinking this non-body or non-self as I, and we got used to it. So why don't we also think of all beings are me? Make the ego very big. Very, very big. So that you almost like you're actually able to defend every suffering because you feel the suffering of others as much as that's yours. So that's why exchanging the suffering of others, taking the suffering of others as was ours, giving our happiness to others as they are us as well. So this is exactly the argument that it has, why we should learn to do that. Now, therefore, then verse number 170 onwards is now learning to actually do the act of exchanging self with others, starting with small. Just as I defend myself, therefore, from all unpleasant happenings, however small, so that just as I slowly learn to do this, however small they are, likewise I shall act for others' sake to guard and protect them with compassion. So just as I do this, then I will also learn to do this for the sake of others. And so therefore it's just a question of training to feel the suffering of others as if it was ours. And exactly, Bodhisattva's best anxiety, you know, Bodhicitta is a perfect anxiety. Your own anxiety is insufficient, it's just miserable anxiety. Make your anxiety perfect anxiety, because you're always worried about other sentient beings. And in many ways, Ananda was said to be like that. Everyone who come to see the Buddha, they get to talk to Ananda first because they have to see him before they see the Buddha. And every time he listens to somebody's story, it just depresses him, you know. He's more upset than the person he's bringing in. But then Buddha said, come on, Ananda, you know, they are driven by their own personal karma. Why are you so overwhelmed with what you can't do? Why are you doing this, you know? So that, of course, talking about Ananda was very, very caring for everybody. He's really empathetic, and he wished he could just relieve their suffering before it has to be brought to the Buddha's attention. You know, that he doesn't realize them being able to speak to the Buddha would bring a big opening, you know, like no other. And he was really, really distressed, I suppose. And Buddha had to tell him that you can't become overly concerned with others if you can't do it. And that was the case. A lot of the people who don't have bodhicitta, they get overwhelmed just by thinking of other suffering. They just feel depresses them, you know. And because they haven't got the bodhicitta. If they have bodhicitta, then it doesn't overwhelm them, or they don't suffer nearly the same as empathic distress. They feel the pain, but not pain cultivated by selfishness. Distinct, very distinct. I suppose one has to experience it. It's just difficult to say what it would be really like to feel somebody suffering, but not as heavily as caused by selfish concern would be.
Is that like keeping your heart open to their suffering and feeling that pain, but realizing the emptiness?
Exactly. Of course, that will be the ideal. Once you understand the emptiness, that would be the ideal, what we call combining the relative and ultimate bodhicitta. In the meantime, you dispense act of compassion to allay their sufferings, whatever you can. But then deep down, you are seeing the emptiness of suffering and the sentient being. And bodhisattvas usually, it's like not tarnished by the sufferings of other beings. They're not, that's why I call not soiled by the mud of samsara, like a lotus. Mud or water in which flower grows actually becomes the very background in which the flower is very beautiful, you know. If the flower itself is withered by the very thing in it grows, then of course it doesn't have a lot of time to beautify anything. And why? Because the one has not realized emptiness. One has not realized emptiness. And that's why the next chapter, in which the ultimate bodhicitta is, with ultimate bodhicitta, it is difficult. And to be able to have ultimate bodhicitta, one has to first practice relative bodhicitta. Almost like back-breaking relative bodhicitta practices. And then you develop merit. Until, if you develop reasonable merit, then you have this emptiness discerning mind, that even the act you performed itself is an illusion. Itself is not truly existent.
If we're dispensing deluded help, what is the difference? How are we actually helping? Is our intention enough to help us to be a benefit to others until we realize some stage where they can score you cheated? Is that enough? Because otherwise we're just deluded beings helping other deluded beings. So how do...
we are always deluded unless we are selfish, selfless. So our own usefulness to help sentient beings, maybe in a partially deluded way, actually makes us our delusion a little bit useful delusion, because we are already deluded anyway, but this way we are able to use our delusion to understand emptiness of it. But if we do not sort of go far enough to burn our fingers helping others, we might think that I've done my bit, you know. We become attached to our personal nirvana. That's exactly the problem, that one thinks that there is a timeline that we should stop and pack up and then finish. But until all sentient beings are liberated, the bodhisattva's purpose is not fulfilled. So however long may it take, bodhisattva do not have the delusion of his task being completed. That's why it's Mahayana, a great vehicle, because at the time point of view, it is three uncountable eons. And in terms of the beings, is all beings. and as a method, is he must use all kind of available method, not just try one. And that's the reason why the if you don't have realized emptiness, yeah, which most sentient beings who practice haven't got, therefore their help becomes more harm to themselves and the other. Yeah, therefore the delusion indeed. That's why we have to retreat and practice until we personally gain sufficient amount of realization that, you know, that can then empower us to give some reasonable help, not just to give them free ride from their suffering, but them to also realize ultimate bodhicitta. If they don't realize ultimate bodhicitta, we might be giving them a few helps here and there, but until we empower them to realize ultimate bodhicitta, even what help we do is no help really. That's why the turning of the first wheel of Dharma, turning of the second wheel of Dharma, turning of the third wheel of Dharma has to be gradated accordingly, because turning of the first wheel of Dharma said there is suffering, there is a cause, there is a way to solve it, and there is a path, you know. And then some people would think that is that, and then, but the second turning wheel of Dharma is not some kind of additional other teaching, but it's actually elaboration of the third noble truth, the cessation of it. The actual cessation of the suffering is realized by lack of self. Unless one realizes a lack of inherent existence self, if you realize lack of inherent existence self, then there is no suffering to remove. There's no suffering to remove. So that elaboration on the second turning of the wheel of Dharma is regarded as person of higher intelligence. Highest intelligence can fathom that, whereas beginners and so on will not be able to fathom that. So that's why Buddha himself had to set out the teaching in three different successions in order to cater people of different levels of faculties, intelligence, and wisdom. So here also, even in this Bodhisattva's way of life, in these 9, 10 chapters, slowly he's talking about how to actually do meditation in caves and spaces, which is away from all noises and obstacles, that you actually survey what really is selfishness like. To actually nail down the selfishness is cause of suffering. It doesn't talk about lack of inherent existence of self here. It almost tried to catch the demon that truly exists type of thing. Almost it tried to tell there is a so-called demon of self-cherishing. It cannot say there is no self in this chapter, because it first have to apprehend the relative cause of all the sufferings. In the relative royal, where dualistic beings always says I and them and you and so on. So therefore it has to highlight the selfishness that is cause of all the suffering and the causes of suffering. Once, of course, you have tell them very clearly that selfishness has been identified as the root cause of suffering and so on, and then by the time you have discovered, by the way, there is no self to be selfish. Oh, you should have told me right at the very beginning. You wouldn't get it. That's why I have to go through all these 9 chapters that maybe Shantideva says even the ninth chapter is sort of very hard, and it gets even harder for if you dwell onto the kind of philosophical aspect of various schools and traditions. But if you can look at the how whole argument is built in this fashion, like say you have to go to solitude, and if you go to solitude, then all the noise will go away, type of thing. But big noisiest thing is the selfishness. Noisiest thing is selfishness. You know, you find them in cave, you can't find them anywhere you go. You don't find them only in cities. You know? So, but you don't discover the selfishness until we are in a quiet place and recognize. And then when argument like that slowly build on the demerits of selfishness, benefit of selflessness, how to adopt oneself and others' role, and maybe have a gut to think we can offer our place to others, when you just do the little role play, and then adopt the idea of our body is not others, and we just adopted it, and so we become so habituated thinking I. Why can't you also learn to adopt others as my, like my son or my brother or someone? Straight away, people are much more willing to do. Straight away, we go and do. If it's for my mother or brother, you will do. But if somebody's mother, we say, oh God, I'm sorry, my sympathy or something. And that's about it. So it shows that how much we are all habituated to our own side and not so quite able to adopt the all beings and as one's mother. And here one needs to therefore learn how to take steps. Like that's why verse number 118 goes to say, this is why the Lord Avalokita, out of great compassion, bless his name, that those caught in the midst of multitude might be released and freed from fear. Because he, of course, Avalokiteshvara is one of the bodhisattvas, is called ever-crying bodhisattva, you know. They take the role of ever-crying bodhisattva. They don't act as they are laughing and this is looking at this sentient being who doesn't exist type of thing. You know, they actually are ever-crying because they're ever-crying bodhisattva. So Avalokiteshvara deliberately took on the role that by my name alone may I give a solace and hope in the mind of others who have suffering. By calling my name, may they find hope to bring a small break into their suffering. Because he knows sentient beings suffering are mostly incessant, and that maybe those who hear my name and the teaching of compassion may be released from that fear, that their sufferings are terminatable, and their suffering is not for eternal. And so therefore, by being able to even say peace, for instance, give peace a chance, they call it. And or the peace workers, or someone put a white flag in the middle of the fight. As soon as you see your enemy put a white flag, you feel really happy, you know. If you see the enemy is incessantly shooting, and you are really troubled, you know. If they put a flag, at least maybe there's a truce. It's like that. So we can try to bring a small truce, small hope amidst the incessant tell of attack and violence and aggression towards each other. And so therefore, Avalokiteshvara vowed that by giving his promise, by mirroring his name, you know, it's just like a firefighter, when a person is burned, they straight away call 000 or whatever. Straight away, they don't have to know who's going to come, whether it's black guy's going to come or small guy's going to come or neighbor's going to come. You never know. But you have just the fact you got the right number. You have hope, isn't it? It's just like that. Bodhisattva try to give a little reprieve, little break to the incessant sufferings of other beings. And so it is quoted in this text that by thrice remembering my name, one will be fearless among crowds. Avalokiteshvara made this vow. Just remember me three times. He says, you will find hope. You'll find hope. And then it says, if sentient beings with disturbed minds hold my name. No form of suffering will occur for them. I'll bless them so that even fears of their surrounding will not arise for them. This kind of hope, this kind of prayer and optimism, we call. Even in scientific research, they say that people of having some faith cope better in crisis just because they have hope. They know the Lord or God or Buddha or whoever they call on, they have someone to call to. At least during the time they have the mind, it gives them some kind of relief. Maybe they have a reason to die for a reason, you know. And so they don't cling onto as if they have to live on type of thing. So like that, Avalokiteshvara. And if we can be of a small termination of somebody's suffering, even a little break, you know, little break, and that's where we start. Take a small steps at a time. You can't make a gallon step to rescue everybody or whole year suffering. Just give them a little, they call caring the carers in our carers industry. Some people are volunteering to care the carers because the carers are just so demanding, you know. The people they look after conditions so bad and they just have to be there always. And they themselves also have hunger, thirst, needs, wishes. They can't do anything, you know. So the caring, the carer is like a bodhisattva's act. It's Avalokiteshvara. It's just simply to give some kind of relief, about suffering. But we have to conceive that. Oh, if I do this, this will relieve him. Oh, what must be like to be relieved them for a while? Oh, wonderful. You never knew it relieved them that much. You thought it was just half an hour, but it made huge difference to them. And slowly we do that, and then we become enticed. We become inspired. Oh, such task is very, very beneficial. And then we find a new stamina and purpose. And a lot of volunteer work is like that. This society is full of volunteers, so many good people. We do not sing their praises. The society doesn't. But if you really look around, there's a lot of people, you know. We think they don't work, or they are not fully engaged, or they don't go to 9-to-5 work, or they don't wear jeans, or they don't wear ties. But they're doing just as many works, you know. You know, they're doing lots of unrecognized works, unidentified, but that. And particularly when they do that with good heart, you know, their life is worth living in spite of all other, sufferings and problems or whatnot. But they really feel useful to have given a little help to somebody. And a lot of people, so we're basically being able to be of use and service to others makes our own suffering useful suffering. But otherwise, even our comfort is not, it's really useless comfort, deluded comfort. That's what it's talking about. So, hence, Bodhisattva, now, is, even though it is difficult, the two benefits are accomplished. When it's really difficult for us, only one benefit is not ever accomplished, only nearly accomplished. Sometimes we fail miserably. Even for one, we don't accomplish. If we suffer for two, Maybe the two benefits are accomplished. So from the point of view of that, verse number 119 goes to say, and so we should be undeterred by hardships. For any influence of use and habit, people even come to grieve for one whose very name strikes terror in their hearts. Next verse also goes to say, those desiring speedily to be a refuge for themselves and other beings should interchange the terms of I and others and thus embrace the sacred mystery. You know, really, the sacred of Dharma is when we drop selfishness and adopt selflessness. And then all of a sudden we can run before we were crawling. It's that says that. When as soon as you do for others, we could run. When we were doing for ourselves, we were just barely able to crawl. It completely gives a higher purpose even to suffer, even to stay up late or whatever. All hardships are worthwhile because it would have double benefit. And you will have no doubt it will have double benefit because it already makes your suffering useful suffering. Because it exhausts your karma as well. You know, it exhausts all the other karmas we don't get to exhaust by doing for others. And so it therefore is definitely sacred. You know, this is the practice. This is why we bow down to Buddha. This is why we bow down to Avalokiteshvara. Because they did this, and not because we like the metal or the material or the art and how all the antique is, we bow down. We bow down because they did, but they did surrender ego. And we try to bow down that we do have to learn to surrender our ego and emulate that selfless task. And that's the reason we bow down. It's not a cultural etiquette. If you do three prostrations just beginning, it's just a cultural kind of Buddhism. If one is sitting in front of the statue or imagine one just doing many, many prostrations to surrender the ego and how they did the surrendering of the ego and fulfill that bodhisattva deeds, we become, maybe we were otherwise very, very confident and arrogant and so on. But it completely humbled us. It completely tamed us. If we feel so honored to know them, is because they practice these things. So it's not only he practiced benefit to him and the other at then, but we have a legacy to follow. We actually have a biography to be told, retold, and never tired of telling. If nobody did it, we could not tell the story that it ever happened. So it's just incessant enlightened activities. Like the Bodhisattva Mahasattva who gave his life to tigers, it's a story they never get tired to be told. People visit there every year. You go many times. It never stops you to inspire that it is possible. So that's why it is the noble of the secret. You know, why is the Buddha being worshipped? Why the Buddha image has such a commanding effect on the eyes of the distressed, so eyes of the confused? Because the very replica itself is to tame the ego and therefore learn to serve the benefit of other sentient beings. So therefore, benefits are... It is said that the first chapter, the benefit of bodhicitta, if as a material form, it would not accommodatable by even by the whole 3,000 world. It is because of that, and the small-minded person do not see why this is we talk so much about bodhisattva's way of life. But once we get a small view of that, and right now its view is blocked by our ego. It's like your view has been blocked by the neighbor who put another floor. You know, even that we complain. We don't complain at the view blocked by selfishness. that's block all the views. All the views were blocked by selfishness. All the discipline was hampered by selfishness, and the view itself blocked by selfishness. But once we truly understand what this conquest is, that's the sacred conquest. This is the what they call arhat of arhats. They have three arhats, you know, small arhat, middle arhat, great arhat. If you talk about Buddhas, they have small Buddha, middle Buddha, great Buddha. The great Buddha or great arhat is one who fully enlightened one. Middle arhat is the bodhisattvas, and so on. So here, one who know this is the recipe that made enlightened ones to become enlightened ones. And so when we recognize this very clearly, and this is the what we should embrace, you know, the take bodhisattva vow means, well, one will embrace to practice selflessness and sacred mystery, you know. People think magic, mystery, some reading of other people's mind or or past life. These are nothing mystery. These are just fantasy, spiritual phantasmagoria. These are not really spirituality. These are people in the domain of myth and magic, things like that. Real secret, is this revelation and being able to conceive that, and then you really have this eye for it. You've got to have an eye and mind for it to read and listen and to meditate. You know, even in the middle of meditation, you remember this and then straight away corrects your mind. But otherwise, your meditation seems like a tedious process of monotonous reading, chanting, turning pages. But you remember this, it straight away enlivens your practice and your attention is fully yielded. When you remember bodhicitta, they say all other virtues like planting tree. With bodhicitta, it is unlike that. You know, never mind the other forms of meditation not going very. As soon as you remember bodhicitta, remember that's the purpose of all. All the mantra reciting, all the sadhanas, all is to remember this secret mystery. Remember this teaching that some people say, oh bodhicitta. That's the talking bodhicitta one. Actually, you need to conceive it. You need to meet it, find it as the most important gem there is to find. Your mind must meet it. That meeting is not describable. It could not be shown, could not be illustrated, could not be described in books. It must be meditated and experienced by paying that attention it warrants. That's exactly why he says, go away in the caves, mountains, away from her, so that you can actually meet the bodhicitta. And you really conceive that. And when you conceive that, like a woman fall pregnant, she becomes selfless. She completely gives in for the child. Likewise, and if you conceive bodhicitta, you know, you give birth to the selflessness. Yeah, and kill the ego. In Vajrayana meditation, it's like that. Most of you are familiar with. You build a sadhana with preliminaries, and then you meditate on emptiness, and then emptiness of self. Then basically you conceive bodhicitta, you know, and you kill the ego, basically. Kill the ordinary ego and when you conceive the bodhicitta. And so the meditation is how to conceive, how to fall pregnant to this bodhicitta. Yeah, Buddha is the father, or sometimes called mother. The perfection of wisdom is the mother of all Buddhas, they call it, because if you realize ultimate bodhicitta, yeah, you will give birth to it. Until you realize that, you can't. And hence, that's why this is the secret that we should embrace for us and others. That's why the Western Tibetan king, Lama Choedak, and his uncle got imprisoned. And he brought gold at the same weight, almost same weight as body weight of his uncle, because the king who imprisoned his uncle demanded the gold the same weight of his uncle, then he will rescue him. His uncle, and the nephew goes and get all gold, whatever he can get from Tibet, and brings it, and the tribal king weighs the gold against the weight of the uncle. His gold was a little too short. Head weight of the uncle was deficient, you know. And then the guy says, you can't, I won't rescue your uncle because the gold is deficient. Gold is still lighter than the weight of your uncle. Maybe he fed him too much. Anyway, so his uncle tells him, he says, you don't waste this gold on me. I'm an elder monk. I'm old monk. I will die anyway very soon. But instead, you take this gold yourself and go to India. You know, don't try to rescue my miserable life. Let me die in prison. You take this gold and invite Atisha to Tibet. And that's exactly what he did, you know. That's exactly, he used the gold to travel all the way to Bengal, you know, Western Bengal. This is like, you know, all the way from Kashmir down to Bengal, and I met her and her, met Atisha, and then invited, you know. And why? To embrace bodhicitta, try to get these teachings that was otherwise lost in various other cultures and traditions, were doing all kinds of other practices. And the very forefathers of Katisha and his teacher and his followers all propagated this bodhicitta. And of course, this bodhicitta, Shantideva is the author, and Shantideva is much earlier than Atisha, remember? Atisha. You know, Atisha. And I'm sure Atisha would study this text, then, and would have embraced this verse 120. So instead of giving this gold, body weight gold, to this notorious king, you know, he said, go and give this to, for the sake of bringing Dharma, pure Dharma to Tibet. Exactly, that's what happened. that highlights the importance of how small benefits, though small though it may be, how it will make oneself to see bigger picture to benefit other beings. So in this way, it now highlights the importance of actually giving, cherish oneself for the sake of others, how to give oneself, thinking of the fear of this life. And that one, 121, he says, because of our attachment to our bodies, we are terrified by even little things. This body then, the source of so much fear, who would not revile it as the worst of enemies? So this means one has to overcome the fear of my body, my life, if we are really able to sacrifice for the sake of. Because that's what Lala Mahishi did. He said, let me die in this prison. I'm already an old monk. It's not going to much use, you know. You instead take that money, go and bring the Dharma, and let me die here. Because he says, look, my body is no use, you know. Let me die here. And just like that. So one has to give up one's body. If one is trying to identify self with the body and always self-preservation with that, then the fear, all fears comes from the fear of dying. But when you know the body is not self, you don't really fear of dying. And he knows that he had lived long already, and he therefore sees no benefit in rescuing his aggregates. But he rather want people to get the Dharma, and therefore he let his nephew not waste the gold to rescue his body, because he was not attached to his body. He was really able to move. This story is very, very powerful. You know, that he was, of course, a descendant of the Dharma king, you know, Dharma king of Tibet, who was expelled to the Western Tibet when all the Tibetan monarch system collapsed in late 10th century. But this descendant of the Tibetan Dharma kings actually became these people, Lama Yeshe, Chengchu, and they actually were the biggest sponsors that brought the Dharma, Atisha, into Tibet after Tibet suffered a huge setback in the early 10th century. So therefore, one should learn to give up one's body. And now, how to give oneself thinking of suffering in the next life. If one doesn't give this life now, then to think of the suffering of next life by preserving this thing as self. He says, wishing to relieve our body's ills, our hungry mouths and dryness of our throats, we lie in wait along the road and steal the lives of fishes, birds, and deer. So he's talking about what we will end up being born to be, no other than devouring and other living beings, because of the self-preservation to our body, we will continue to be reborn, and we will be reborn to devour and hunt and live on other living beings' life. Further on, the next two verses goes to same point. Wishing to Yeah, and for the body's service and advantage. Some there who even kill their parents. Yeah, it's talking about people who are so attached to this life, they don't know the consequences of their aggression to each other will only make them to be born as a living being who only devour other living beings. So some even because they are so attached to their body, they go to kill the very parent who gave birth to them, or steal what has been offered to the triple gem, because of which they will burn in the deepest hell. So this is talking about the fearsome suffering that awaits if one do not let go this body for the benefit of others. If one become enslaved by the body, then one is creating more suffering, what would be in the next incarnation. Where then is the prudent man who wants to pamper and protect his body? He says, one who is always possessed and attached to his body. And of course, this is particularly true when people want to retreat. As soon as their body suffers, they straight away give up the body retreat. So that's because they think they want a fit body to be buried under the soil. They don't want a fit practice to be carried in the next life. So they exchange between the remains and. They want to take remains with them, maybe. Who will not ignore and treat with scorn what is for him a dangerous enemy? So Shantideva talking about one who is completely enslaving themselves, try to guard and protect and venerate and protect this very thing that is not protectable at all. And it is basically by day, by even 1 hour's elapsing, it is self-depreciating. It is self-depreciating, you know. It doesn't have any appreciating value. It only costs more. Self-depreciating, you know. Every other goods also depreciating, I'm told. So we also, as we get aging, we also depreciating. Yet we wanted to guard and protect the very thing that has become less and less value. As soon as we don't breathe, those people who love us, usually cuddle us, they will run away. They will not even dare to come in the room by themselves. So that is what we're trying to guard. That is what we wanted to feed. That is what we wanted to protect. That is what we wanted to look. So therefore, who among wise should not regard this body but an enemy? You know, he says, if we are enslaved by it, that's what I'm saying. It doesn't mean you should waste it. It doesn't mean you should treat the body with contempt. Of course, it means put this to good use before it just totally depreciates and become useless and a burden, a cause of doubt and suspicion. And they said there's a dead body. Everybody's worried about dead body. They are actually preparing one. Everybody's preparing, protecting this dead body. as it gets better as it goes. So Shantideva was arguing how not to be enslaved by the body, to practice selflessness. Because if we so become protective and guarding the body, then we end up not giving up anything, our comfort or our things, for the sake of others. There's no bodhisattva growing. You will not see a bodhisattva growing if one is so enslaved, attached to his or her body. And practitioners are alike, you know. So having argued that, now advantages of other good qualities and disadvantages of one's own faults. So this is the firstly the detailed explanation, and then summary with the metaphors. First is detailed explanation, 125. He says, if I give this, what will be left for me? Thinking of oneself the way of evil ghosts. If I keep this, what will be left to give? Concern for others is the way of heaven. So this is talking about the sometimes we feel as what will I do? nothing will be left of me. If I give the very body or if I give the very thing I have, there wouldn't be anything left for me. And thinking this, we feel very, very stingy and miserly and always restraining from giving. And he says, this is the way of evil hungry ghosts. You know, you are actually creating cause of hungry ghosts. The more you excuse, more you find reasons not to give or procrastinate, whatever you do, you are actually not preserving this body, but you are feeding on hungry ghosts that it will soon become. And so, therefore, instead, if we choose the other, if I keep this, what will be left to give? Concern for others. If I do use this, then it will be at least beneficial to others. It's almost like my purpose is to service and help others. And before I die, if I can do useful service and I just get used for what I'm brought up or what I vowed for, then it is actually direct cause of winning the opposite of hell, what he calls heaven, meaning higher, better incarnation, or the realms that are highly regarded by others. To serve myself, I harm another's. So this is talking about what normal, ordinary people do. One harms others. Whether it's flies or whether it's people or things, oh, he's harming me, why should I? Then we try to straight away do something. I will suffer later in the hell realm. So this is what Bodhisattva now sees of the disadvantage. Disadvantage of protecting oneself, harming somebody. Even though we think we can because we are more powerful, to do that, but actually that is direct cause for the actual hell-like suffering. If for others' sake I harm myself, means if for the sake of others, if I expose myself to a little harm, like Lama Yeshua did, you know, let himself be put in a cage for the rest of his life. He says, even I die in this, because here in the modern world, foreign families would do anything to rescue the person, but when he's out, he's more dangerous. He's not much better, you know. They want to rescue the person. Actually have no help. But Lala Maheshi says, let I be harmed in this cage and let my time, doing the time in this, be useful so that the excellence of benefit of Dharma in the Tibet in the future will be everybody's. Amazing vision, yeah? That's exactly what he did. Every excellence will be my heritage. His name's not forgotten. Why? Because that's exactly what he said to his little nephew. Imagine your nephew comes to ransom you, to rescue you from a prison, bail you out. And you say, oh, my dear, you're so good, but don't waste those $3 million. Just go and donate to the local soup kitchen or something. I'm going to die anyway. You know, let my death be useful. And by rescuing me, you bailing out all that money, what good are you going to do? You know, it's not going to benefit me. So let me just stay, die in prison, but take the money, you know. That's why the great many beings, bodhisattvas or whatever, most of the monks, they got imprisoned in Tibet. Nobody is trying to bail out anybody. They say they have a reason to be there. And its greatest test is to practice bodhicitta when you really have to, you know, risk it, and not risk, but happily suffer for whatever cause it is. Those who didn't waver their bodhicitta, they come out after 27 years, 50 years, become the legacy. Their names are not forgettable. Yeah, it became the heritage of Buddha Dharma. You know, Buddha is not always being born walking seven steps every time, you know. You know, not every Buddha born with as soon as born walking seven steps. Some Buddhas have to spend in jails in order to actually do what Shakyamuni Buddha taught in Saranath, in Vulture's Peak. And that's more important, isn't it? Otherwise, everybody's showing miracles, you know. They think that's a Buddha. And then that's where people get wrong idea of Buddha in Buddhahood. So this people who actually, Shantideva's work became the very kind of a, what do you call that? It becomes a manual to do the teachings of the Buddha in your life when you are in such extreme danger situations. They quite a lot of them prayed if they could die in prison, but they just couldn't believe they were rescued. Because Kenpo Kunga Onju never asked to be freed from his prison. He just did some changes in the kind of government rules and political direction of the government, and then just really he didn't know he was rescued. He thought it's okay, and now he was able to go, and then he slowly found his way to India. You see, and because your hardship has to have a high purpose, even success if no high purpose, it's cause for further downfall. So that's exactly what takes oneself to learn to disown the body, disown the I, and own the bodhicitta. It's what amazing exchange that it is, you know. You can never stop somebody suffering by doing that, you know. But what it's really exchanging is the selfishness is dropped. And selflessness has been adopted. That's a real exchange of self and others. You know, otherwise Bodhisattva would have taken everybody suffering with his broom, you know, if that's what taking Tonglen's Tavas. Tonglen is just a training. It's just like a little rehearsal. The actual practice is to give up the selfishness and adopt the bodhicitta. Then it becomes the excellent heritage that people can really remember and rejoice. And yeah, I mean, we are here because of there is this living heritage. There is where these teachings are pulsating. These teachings are striking a chord in our middle of our crisis. If you remember this, you will find enormous ability to somersault your way of resolving situation. It's the rigidity that we don't hear these teachings, heed these teachings, that we always get stumbled, that we get stopped. We just stand offish with the world because there isn't this realization happening. We only read it. We only nod it when we listen to it, when we reflect on it. But we must not forget this. Bodhicitta is not forgetting this, that the thing that we have a child that we have conceived, and take precaution not to eat this, not to eat that, so that the child will be given birth safely. This is the whole analogy of becoming pregnant or becoming conceiving a child and making sure all great take care is given. You know what? As soon as ladies you can pregnant, you can see how much she's willing to sacrifice. She changes, she drops many things for the safety of the health and future of the child. It is not her, but she just completely given her space, her tummy, her comfort, her figure, her convenience, her career, usually straight away gone. It's an example of motherhood is a very important one. Perfection of wisdom is called mother, actually. But mother is not fertile, is not a mother. So until we intellectually and emotionally feel completely mesmerized and completely feel turned on, so to speak, we cannot conceive bodhicitta. The concept, idea, yes, but actually it has to touch every cell of us to the extent of directing and almost like some kind of aha realization takes place within our heart. Wanting what is best for me, stupidity and lower realms result. That's right. So he's talking about the demerit of selfishness. If you're thinking of what I want, what is it in here for me today? What is in here for me last few weeks? Oh, it's not working for me. I'm not doing this. That kind of mind is stupid. Is the result is just lower realms because that's so low. It's so obvious. It doesn't have to even check what actually is. let this be changed, he says. Like I said, so awful, so smelly, so low. It had to be changed. It is not possible. Apply to others, honors and realm of bliss will come. But we think of, for the sake of others, which is exactly opposite, which is instead of stupidity, is wise, is instead of lower, it's a higher, and therefore change. It's a changing, you know, just basically changing the mind. Changing the mind. Bodhicitta is just changing the selfish citta, selfish thought, into the selfless thought. Enslaving others, forcing them to serve me, I will come to know the state of servitude. And talking about the karmic consequences of self-centeredness and then making others do as we're more powerful or we're domineering or like that is actually causing oneself to suffer incessant servitude. They say the life of servitude, those people who are doing things not willingly and unhappily having to do, you know, servitude is not service, all services, you know. All service is, if one does willingly, it's not servitude. But those who have to do, most people's jobs are servitude because they really don't want to do it. They have no interest to help, or they really don't think it, this they want to do, but because they think there's got a little bit of benefit to them, they do. Otherwise, they have no delight or willingness or to practice tolerance or cooperate or respect or... That is servitude, indeed. We don't have to imagine future servitude. All kinds of notion people call it's just a job. It shows it's a servitude. It's an animal in human body that is made, forced to work what they don't want to work. What they want to do, they don't get. If they got it, they probably become another servitude too, because that kind of attitude wouldn't get any job, delightful job. It's the attitude that makes free of servitude. But if I labor for the good of others, never mind the job. Never mind the job, whether it's chopping wood. In the Zen teaching, they say, first enlightenment, then chop the wood. Yeah, enlightenment first, yes, practice enlightenment. But then what do you do? Chop the wood. So actually you got to do things that actually everybody needs and so on. So even enlightenment is not so great if you don't chop wood or whatever that need to be done. But if you did willingly, chopping wood is enlightening. You see? See, but if I labor for the good of others, mastery, leadership will come to me. Then actually, it's some kind of, quite a lot of people do ordinary tasks are nowadays honored by society, isn't it? They're respected, they are receiving, I don't know, whatever society and community give the recognition and so on. And yeah, they did all those things, but their heart was never low, but high indeed. And karma is very, 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 very well-rounded. It never defeats, never deceives, never forgets, never fails to compliment. And so when one has this kind of unlosable faith in choosing which is better, whether doing something with as under kind of duress type of thing, or doing something with great delight of selflessness. So it's not so much the nature of the job, but with what kind of will and determination one does, makes the difference. So Shantideva, it's not the job what we do, it's the attitude which one do. So our everyday activities, because this is engaged bodhicitta, in everyday activities is what one does so willingly. And as soon as one does, one of course meditates on the lack of inherent existence. And while emphasizing we have to do this, a lot of people do, but they haven't heard the ultimate bodhicitta meditation that they need to integrate with the practice such as this. All the joy the world contains has come from wishing happiness for others. Be it Mother Teresa, you know, be it Buddhist saints or His Holiness Dalai Lama or whoever, when you really look at those people who are nowadays revered, or only after death they tend to recognize them as saint, is because they did these things for the benefit of others, themselves willing to rub shoulder with the leper colony and work with them early hours, who doesn't matter what, and has come from wishing, not only wishing others, but doing things that made others happy. Now the person is dead, but story of it makes other people happy. Yeah, this is what we're talking about. All the misery the world contains has come through wanting pleasure for oneself. So it's talking about, this is highlighting and concluding that by the demerit of selfishness, like a poison, who wanted to go there? Merit of selflessness, like a blissful. Why shouldn't we go and embrace that? That's the secret mystery. And so in societies where they say, I should look after myself always, that kind of society always treats competitiveness, always think of put self first, freedom, independence, all these illusory names that actually don't exist. The real sacred mystery, sacred and secret mystery, is being able to be with others, do for the others, being oneself, willing to be the forgotten one. And it's one who does that is actually one gives most happiness. And then it concludes with the metaphor, on next 130 verse, Is there need for lengthy explanation? He's talking to himself after writing 130 verses. And he says, he's still got another 60 verses to come, but he says, is there need for lengthy explanation? Childish beings look for out for themselves. So that's it. While Buddhas labor for the good of others. See the difference that divides them. So it's very clear. This is a very famous quote, this one, in Tibetan. Almost like after you said a lot about bodhicitta, if you want to conclude it, this is a very beautiful verse to conclude it. It says you can see the difference between Buddha and ordinary childish beings. And Drukpa Khunle, Tibetan mad 15th century practitioner, did the same. He goes to Lhasa and he sees the Buddha image, Shakyamuni Buddha image. Of course, he was a little realized as well, but he pretended that he's not. Usually people come to the Buddha shrines and they recite formulas, refuge or whatever, for established prayers. You know, they don't quite spontaneously invent like that. But he spontaneously said to the statue, before you and I were same. You through your diligence got enlightenment. I due to my laziness, I'm still lost in samsaras. Now it's my turn to bow down to you. Then he prostrated. It's like that. Yeah, so Drupa Kungli is saying, I was selfish all this time, so I have stuck in samsara. And we were equal, remember? We went to school at the same first time, type of thing. He said, before we were together, you know. But you, due to your diligence, you got enlightened. Now it's my turn to honor you. So it's like that here. The difference is different between one who bow down and one bow to is actually the one who bow in to is now benefited by the other's diligence, and become a cause of his inspiration. See, his enlightenment is not like a lamp that when it runs out of fuel, it goes in black, empty. The Buddha may have come and gone, but his legacy is constantly remembered and inspired people like Drukpa Khunle, and that is the sacred mystery. That is sacred mystery. It gives all the things so strong going. Thank you. That's all we have time for. Nice place to stop. Okay, we'll read the rest of the extract. In the spiritual energy that relieves the anguish of beings in misery and places depressed beings in eternal joy, I lift up my heart and rejoice in the goodness producing illumination. I lift up my heart and rejoice. I rejoice in the beings who have gained eternal liberation from suffering. And I rejoice in those who attain Buddhahood, as well as their offspring, the noble Bodhisattvas. In the ocean of virtue of body and mind that brings joy to all beings and accomplishing the well-being of others, I lift up my heart and rejoice. To the Buddhas of the Ten Directions, I rejoice my hands. Let blaze the light of Dharma's truth for the beings lost in darkness. To the Buddhas considering parinirvana, I join my hands in prayer. Do not abandon the beings in sorrow, but remain, teach the countless ages. May any spiritual energy thus generated by my devotion to the enlightened ones be dedicated to dispelling the misery of living beings without exception. As long as disease afflicts living beings, may I be the doctor, the medicine, and also the nurse who restore them to health. May I fall as a rain to increase the harvest that needs these living beings. And in ages of dire famine, may I serve food and drink. May I be an unending treasury for those desperate and forlorn. May I manifest of what they require and wish to have near them. My body, every possession, all goodness, past, present, future, without remorse, I dedicate to the well-being of the world. Suffering is transcended by total surrender, and the mind returns to nirvana, and one day it must all be given up. Why not dedicate for now a universal happiness? My bodily powers I dedicate to the well-being of all that lives. Should anyone wish to kill, abuse, or beat me, the responsibility will be wholly their own. Should anyone wish to ridicule me and make me an object of zest and concern? Why should I possibly care if I have dedicated myself to others? Let them do as they wish with me, so long as I do not harm them. No one may encounter me in significant contact. Regardless whether those whom I meet respond towards me with anger or faith, the mere act of anger contributes to the fulfillment of their wishes. May the slander, harm, and all forms of abuse that anyone should direct towards me act as the cause of their enlightenment. May I be protector of the helpless, guide for those traveling the path, boat to those wishing to cross over, or a bridge or a raft. May I be land for those requiring, a land for those in darkness, and may I be home for homeless and servants. In order to fulfill the needs of beings, may I be a magic gem, an inexhaustible well, mystic spell, cure, medicine, wish-granting tree. May I act as the mighty earth or like the free sky, to support and provide wide space, where I and others may grow. Until my brain, my fleet, my pain has reached Nirvana's shores, may I serve only as a condition that encourages progress and joy. Just as all various Buddhas just give rise to precious Bodhimaya, and then carefully follow the stages of Bodhisattva discipline. Likewise, for the sake of all sentient beings, do I now myself generate Bodhimaya. Likewise, will remain in the discipline of a Bodhisattva. They who are of wisdom have seized the Supreme Bodhimaya. Praise, glorify, and rejoicing that I may gain in the fulfillment. From today I reap the fruits of life, having well won the state of man. Today I am born in Buddha family and child of the Buddha. Thus in future I should make every effort to live accord with Bodhisattva's way. Never should I act as would bring shame to those in the fullest love. Like a blind fumbling garbage happens to find a rare and precious gem, likewise I would encourage this whole precious body mind. Thus was found the Supreme Bruce here to dispel the door to dwell, destroy wealth, and exhaust for treasure, or to cure poverty of all sentient beings. His highest feelings and medicine, curled is a tree giving shade to those wandering in the path of life. It is strong and mighty rivers, which is it is the moon that shines the mind, clear away all pains and delusion. The body and mind is a great radiant sun to dispel darkness of unknown, and its very essence of butter is gained from churning the milks of Dharma. For all guests on the roads of life who would take the very sustenance joy, he is the actual feed of true happiness, a veritable feast to satiate the world. Thus today, in the presence of all awakened ones, I invite every being to this festival, giving both immediate and lasting joy. May the gods and all others rejoice.